The Executive Office Committee meeting this afternoon. We are quorate, and just to remind members that we are being recorded and it is being broadcast live. Just to ask members to be aware of just their technology and in front of microphones in case it causes any disruption. And we have today three members joining us by Starleaf. We have George Robinson, Emma Sheeran and Pat Sheehan, so they're very welcome via Starleaf. And we're just waiting on Trevor Clark arriving at some point as the business starts. We have... I'm way ahead of myself. Draft minutes then. Members, the draft minutes of the meeting, it was held on the 11th of November at page 5 of the meeting. Are members content that they are a true reflection of the proceedings?
Yeah.
Okay, so they've been signed and ready to pass over. There are no matters arising from that, which means that we can move straight into item 4, which is the Special EU Programmes Body, the oral evidence session. Members, on pages 14 to 61 of the meeting pack, you can find the relevant papers. And just to remind members that the committee had agreed to schedule an oral briefing on the role of the Special EU Programmes Body as part of the committee's scrutiny of cross-cutting Brexit issues. So at this point, I can welcome to the meeting Gina McIntyre, who's the Chief Executive of the Programmes Body, and Declan McGarrigle, who's the Programme Manager. Just to advise both of you, after welcoming both of you, just to advise you that we are being recorded by Hansard and that the transcript will be published on the committee webpage. It always sounds almost like a threat that like anything to say will be used against you, but it's just to advise you of that there, but it doesn't have to sound... It does just sound that little bit threatening, but definitely not meant as such, so...
You have the right to remain silent, but it won't be much of a committee meeting if you do.
Anyway, you're very welcome. Thank you very much. And it's also good as well at times to get people in the room because we sort of miss that because a lot of it is done through Starleaf. So normal procedures, maybe to let yourselves start off with a bit of a presentation and then we can work around to members and ask for some questions at that point. So if you're content with that, we'll pass over to yourselves.
Okay, thank you very much. And thank you very much for the invitation to be here today to talk about the work of the Special EU Programmes Body and in particular the Peace and Interreg Programmes. I have submitted a briefing paper, so without going through all of that again, it would be my intention just to give you some of the key highlights out of that in relation to the current programmes and future programmes, if that's okay.
Lovely.
The Peace Programme is a value of £269 million, and the Interreg Programme has a value of £283 million. Both of those programmes, I'm happy to report, are overcommitted, and the Peace Programme is overcommitted to £277 million and Interreg to £291 million. And that's a really it's a management technique that's used for these programmes to ensure that we maximise expenditure and getting the EU receipts back by the end of the programmes, because invariably projects will underspend during the lifetime. And so this will be a position that we will maintain, and indeed it will change, will be overcommit by certain amounts throughout the next couple of years. Our priorities are obviously to stay overcommitted and ensure full expenditures recouped. COVID has proved a problem, obviously, in relation to our projects, but we as an organisation have been working remotely since March. We have worked on a case-by-case basis with each of those projects that we fund, because we fund in so many sectors across the two programmes. They have a variety of different problems that occur, or you know, different challenges that they've faced over this past 6 months. So we have been able to offer flexibility in relation to the projects where we can. I have to actually commend the projects. They've been fantastic in coming up with innovative ways to deliver and carry on, you know, looking after their beneficiaries, which is really, really important. We've been as flexible as we can be in relation to indicators. We put in an emergency payment right from the beginning so that they didn't... Obviously, we knew there'd be problems with paperwork, so we were able to assign an emergency-type payment, which would be then verified later on. Some of the projects took that up. And it's our duty to ensure the projects stay viable so that they can stay eligible for the funding. At this stage, we'll have to say... Given the overcommitment in the current programmes, there wouldn't be any extra money that we can offer to projects to dealing with COVID. But what we do instead is look at outputs. We look at lengths of the letter of offer, you know, in terms of extending them and that type of thing. So in the peace programme, we fund areas such as shared education, support for victims, survivors, a lot of support for children and young people, 0 to 24 and 14 to 24. And actually, those projects in particular have been, they're not only innovative, but absolutely hilarious in some of the ways they've been able to keep their beneficiaries involved in the work that they're doing. So it's all about confidence building and building resilience. We've just recently launched the mental health project for young people, which is great to see that out in the public as well. We obviously have a shared spaces element, so we've got a lot of capital buildings coming on stream this year, and we have regional-wide projects, all of which are working successfully. The local action plans, every council has a local action plan, and they're all working very well. Quite a few of them obviously are completing, and but so far everything's going well there. We also have a peace platform project, which is a wonderful project. It's a repository of 25 years worth of the peace programmes. So it's just coming to fruition now, and we're hoping to launch it in January. And it has brought together all of the case studies from projects, lessons learned, reports, oversight, you know, evaluations and all of that. So that's going to be a fantastic learning tool for other projects to learn how, you know, maybe how to avoid some mistakes or indeed get ideas. Because as you would know, we get a lot of foreign visitors who come here to find out some of the excellent work the projects do. So they'll be able to do this now online with this learning platform. Our Interreg programme funds in the areas of research and development, so particularly in the area of health and life sciences, so it's PhD research, also support for SMEs and bringing in research to bring products and services to the market. We also have sustainable transport in the Interreg programme, and I should mention the Interreg programme includes Western Scotland as well as a partner there. So we have the transport area, which we have funded three greenways, and also the multimodal hub up in the waterside in Derry, Londonderry there. We do a lot of cross-border healthcare. 50,000 patients will be treated throughout the different projects that we're doing, in acute services, community interventions, particularly out in the rural areas where they can bring together critical mass of patients, you know, to be able to deliver these. We have some services for the disability and also medical care and medicines. So there's a lot of really excellent work goes on there, indeed in all your constituencies. The environment is also a major part of the Interreg programme, and we fund in the areas of protecting habitats and species, and also water quality. So one of our projects recently, unfortunately at the weekend, there had a landslide in an area of that they were assessing it out in the Derg area for they were assessing the water quality and what they could do, and it was very unfortunate to hear that for the project, but the impact that might have. So we have been, that's the position with the two current programmes. We also are a partner, or we are the Northern Ireland contact point for transnational programmes, and Declan would do a lot of work in that area, but that would be in a lot of areas of renewable energy and water and marine life. So that's been a strong part of the overall programmes, although not our two direct ones, but you know that has leveraged in 16 million into the region. The Peace Plus programme then, as you're aware, is a programme that has been committed to in the withdrawal agreement, and we started consultation on that programme last August. We were very fortunate in that we were able to go out and speak to all the permanent secretaries and the assistant sec-generals in Dublin and the Irish departments. Because we started at that time, we also had a series of public events, and we had over 1,000 people attended those in the early part of this year, January, February time. And we went to every county, and as I said, the citizens came along and gave us their views. Some of them that they didn't hold back in their criticisms, but that was fine. We got excellent input from them. We also had surveys, and we had 320 surveys submitted, which again outlined the challenges they thought for the region and what they would like to see. The Peace Plus programme is based on the framework that the EU has ascribed to all programmes across Europe, and we have selected the themes that we think are most beneficial for this region. That's based on a socioeconomic study that was carried out in Northern Ireland and the border region of Ireland by the economists here in the Department of Finance and the Department of Public Expenditure Reform in Dublin as well. They work jointly on that. That will obviously be updated for the impact of COVID. The ministers have given us great support in the projects, that's Minister Murphy in the Department of Finance and Minister McGrath in the Department of Public Expenditure Reform in Dublin, who are our sponsor departments, and they have given us a clear vision for what they would like to see in the programme, which is very much about community interventions, rural interventions in those areas most impacted, and also to ensure we leave a lasting legacy. So we have looked at all of the government priorities here in Northern Ireland and in the border counties of Ireland. We've taken on board all the information we have. We also have to take on board the Green Deal, which is a climate agenda from the Commission. We're also looking at the UN Sustainable Development Goals and the impact that they would have on the programme. And I have to say, luckily for us, everything aligns very, very well. And we have developed six themes from that. We also then are looking very much, as I said, about ensuring that our communities are, we're working with communities and for communities in this future programme. No, I'm not sure if you want me to go through the six themes or give you an overview of the six themes for the Peace Plus programme. Is that okay?
Sort of a light overview.
Great, just a high level overview, yeah. So the first theme is about building peaceful and thriving communities, and it's very much focused on the type of activity I've mentioned already that we're funding in the Peace programme, although obviously it's been brought up to date and it's been changed dependent on what we've heard from the communities. So there will be local action plans in all councils, but we're going to make sure that these are co-designed with communities and really address local needs within the communities. And we want to look at areas such as regeneration and transformation. We want to look at building positive relations and also celebrating identity, diversity and culture within that. We're also looking at empowering communities, and we have put in place there a small grant scheme which will be for smaller projects that maybe wouldn't be going through the council schemes, but that should be on a much less administratively burdensome type application form, and but because they're smaller. And they're again going to look at building good relations and peace building. We're looking at also in that area the institutional capacity building, and that will be at all levels of the community, from political level right down to the local level and through all the statutory agencies. And an interesting aspect that we're hoping to bring into this programme is justice interventions in the community to help build peace by establishing relationships and understanding there. Building positive relations would be regional-wide projects that are looking at, again, celebrating identity, celebrating diversity, and looking to build on relationships and understanding between communities, and they're a very successful part of the current programme. We will also look at re-imaging communities in the shared spaces and services element, and we want to particularly consider some of the impacts of COVID in the likes of community areas, villages, towns, and some of the retail streets that will maybe be left derelict, with a real emphasis on the new shared spaces as being re-establishment of older buildings and not all but brand new. We want to see regeneration in that area. The second theme is about delivering economic regeneration and transformation. Again, support for SMEs. We're looking at skills development. We're looking at research and innovation there, a regional skills programme. We're also looking at smart cities, towns and villages. The third investment area is in empowering and investing our young people. So learning together educational programme, very much like the shared education programme. There'll be a Peace Plus youth programme, which is about the confidence building and resilience and taking them forward to vocational training skills, and youth mental health programme as well. The fourth area, healthy and inclusive communities. As I mentioned, the Interreg programme funds on a cross-border basis a lot of health interventions, medical health interventions. So we will carry on doing that work because that's been extremely successful. But also we want to look at community well-being, health and well-being within communities, and getting the communities involved in what they can do in services, because there's a lot of work that communities can do to enhance the medical services for their areas. There'll be support for victims and survivors in that theme, and also rural development and regeneration, because there are a lot of areas of isolation, and for rural development we really want to bring that on. Fifth area, supporting a sustainable future. So that's, again, the biodiversity, the recovery and resilience, marine and coastal management, water quality and sustainable transport in that theme as well. But once again, we're able to bring communities in there to see how communities can look at making their own local areas more sustainable for the future. And the last theme is theme six. It's a mandatory theme within the programme and through all programmes, Interreg programmes in Europe. And it's about building and embedding partnerships and collaboration. So in that theme, it looks particularly at the legal and administrative challenges of a border and what can be done to address those. So it could be the likes of skills recognition on both sides of the border, that type of thing. And it's an area that I would expect that the administrations will work together on in addressing some challenges. And again, we're looking at a small project theme in there, which is about maintaining and forging relationships for communities going forward over the next few years. That's a summary. And that's just a summary.
Well, Dana, thank you very much indeed for that. I was trying to think, as you were talking, of a way maybe to introduce this next session of the questions. And I've kind of written down, you said the silent deliverers in Northern Ireland. Not everybody is aware of the work that you do, but yet the work that you do and the funding that you provide probably touches just about everybody's life. And as you've detailed there, the level and the scale of the programmes that you're actually involved in, be it people going out for a walk on a beach and there'll be some form of environmental programme that has been funded and delivers there, right through to maybe a refurbished building in the town centre, through to maybe some groups that people are part of, to the young people participating in programmes, right across the whole spectrum. People are just about everybody is probably engaging in some form. And I would say that there's probably many as a minister in the executive that would love to have the funding that you have to be able to deliver out for programmes, because there's great scope that's there. So well done to everybody in the work that yous are doing and the impact that yous are having, and especially in the dual year that we're in of having the COVID impact, but then also dealing with the uncertainty that there is going forward in terms of Brexit and how that might implicate things. And I suppose that's something that I would maybe like to start off with, just to get an understanding from yourselves that obviously you've talked about literally hundreds of millions of pounds that has been delivered in the everyday life here in Northern Ireland. And just saying, maybe if you could give us an update of where you see things going forward. Now, we did receive yesterday an update on the North-South Ministerial Council meeting, and I know that there has been a guarantee that the rest of this programme cycle will actually be funded and that money is there. But I get a sense that there is uncertainty at the other end of that as opposed to a guarantee as what will happen. So can you give me maybe your understanding of what might take place as a result of Brexit?
Yeah, the current programmes, you're right, there is a commitment that they will be seen right through to the end. And we would work with our projects very carefully to make sure that any implications from Brexit, what those implications might be on the projects. As yet, as you would know, it's quite unknown what the implications might be. And we would be hopeful that a lot of what may come to pass won't happen in the next year or two. So those projects that are completing out will be able to complete out in the same manner. But we will keep on top of that as we, as the situation unfolds next year and the year after. There is also a commitment in the withdrawal agreement for this Peace Plus programme. And the EU has put down, they had 60 million in addition to Ireland's contribution of ERDF funding. That's the funding that comes directly from the Commission. They had that, and also Ireland would put forward 60 million. And then the UK had committed to 300 million. Now, all of that then gets matched by government interventions as well, from each of the departments. So we have worked with each of the departments, and again, I would like to pay homage to the work that the officials have done in all of those departments, because they've worked fantastically with us for the last year, and they work jointly with their counterparts in Ireland, and they've put forward joint proposals for the priorities that they want. So they've been deeply involved in the development of the programme. But they will all put forward their match funding elements to add to the programme. And so currently the programme sits at about 650 million, and that it has been committed to. Now, what has happened in the last 6 months, probably, the EU has added a further 60 million on top of the 60 that they had already guaranteed, and the Irish government have added a further 27. So that means that if the UK matched it in the proportions that you would currently expect, you would see a much larger programme. But that's all worked out between the UK and the EU in terms of the negotiations, I would expect. So we're working on the basis we have a firm commitment for that £650 million programme for Peace Plus.
Okay, and I think that's maybe that should be something that, we should keep an eye on with you to make sure that that commitment is honoured or is pursued. Insofar as, you know, if we can maximise our influence to try and ensure that that money is matched and drawn down, because, I mean, again, just as I say, reiterating how you just cut it right across all of society, I wanted to say as well, I really welcome hearing you talking about youth mental health as a as an area. It's obviously, as it, you know, increasingly becoming an issue. It's great to see that user funding as a priority projects that will tackle that. And I like that flexibility that you have, that if there are emerging needs, that you're able to fund programmes that are actually able to target those needs. Because, again, there is almost a flexibility there that sometimes there isn't within departments. So, you know, it's really good and reassuring to know that yous are there to be able to deliver them. My final question then really is just, you mentioned about the sort of co-design process. Do yous embed that into the groups that apply to you, or is that something that yous would do, just co-designing at your level, or is it something that you can try and push out right across?
We'll be pushing it out to the local councils, because we'll be it's very much in line with the community planning as it is, but we'll be asking them to co-design the peace action plans with, because they get an allocation of funds directly. They don't have to bid competitively for them. So we'll be able to tell them, you know, that they can go and start work developing with the local communities what they need, and that co-design work will happen. Now, what we intend to do is provide support for that next year, to get that up and running, and that may be that we provide some individuals to work with the councils to actually enable them to do that work, because obviously I know with COVID everybody's very restricted in what they can do. So we are going to provide some support for that, to embed that process in the planning.
Thank you. Look, I'm going to pass to the Vice Chair, Deputy Chair, Doug.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. Gina, thank you for that. I mean, it's fascinating, it's really interesting. Can I just ask just one very brief question and something else? On the piece four, you talk about shared education and how you're supporting shared education. Do you do much with the integrated sector?
No, we don't directly in this current programme. We don't. We fund the shared education, which is about two schools coming together and the signature type projects. But the integrated education sector can apply in there, and there were other areas that they could have applied. I do talk to the integrated education and quite recently did. There will be more explicit references to the integrated education in the Peace Plus programme. So in that learning together educational programme, it's actually specifically referenced as well. The integrated education can be involved there.
All right, thanks to you. The other one is, and I mean, this is interesting to me for a degree at the minute. On the Peace Plus, you talk about building peaceful and thriving communities and building positive relationships. And I think there was an article out, it might have been the last couple of days, which said that in over this COVID pandemic, in some areas where paramilitaries have control, they're suffering more from what's happening in regards to COVID. And it made me wonder, how much of a link do you have into the likes of the executive action plans, or indeed into the Department for Justice, for example, the action plan on paramilitarism, criminality and organised crime, which is in a particular community, and the paramilitaries task force, which is the hard force piece to that. And use it then delivering stuff into communities. How do you deconflict what you're putting into communities to what the action plan is trying to achieve, or what the police are trying to do with their task force?
We make sure we don't do the same, and we do that by working with the officials closely. So for in the executive office, we'll work very closely with them, and when we're designing the programme, and when we're putting out the calls, to make sure that it's in line with their policy but is not overlapping on their other activity. Or indeed, what we try to do is we're trying to be complementary to the activity that they're doing. So we maybe wouldn't go in on the hard side of some of those schemes. We would go in maybe on the softer side.
Yeah.
and working in relationships building, but we would always make sure that each of the relevant departments are involved in the design of those calls and to make sure that the projects that we fund are not overlapping on theirs.
Yeah, and I mean, that's good, right? And I fully get that used to be the soft power piece, and I get that. That's not the, that, you know, I never thought anything other than that. I guess it's when you look at if you look at the action plan and they talk about communities and tradition in transition, and they have eight output areas in regards to that. Mm-hmm. And it's just, you know, just getting a sense that you're fully built into what they're doing, and you're complementary and not doing something that's completely different to that. Is that?
Yeah, we would be, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Want to say, Declan?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it goes back to the point that Gina's already made. I mean, we've had extensive engagement this year with all government departments on a north-south basis, you know, and I think that process is really standing us in good stead, I suppose, in terms of where we've arrived now, in terms of the development of the six themes and the various investment areas. So, you know, it's a process that's ongoing, it's intensive, you know. At the moment, there's a review process in terms of the investment areas and thematic papers that we've supplied them to the departments. So it's an extensive and it's an ongoing process, you know, in terms of ensuring that it is a complementary, you know, in terms of what we're proposing as part of this.
And we also had 80 officials attended together jointly from all the government departments in Northern Ireland that we are involved with, which actually was all the government departments, back in November. This time last year, all came together in a room together when we were talking about the programme and the and finding areas of complementarity between, say, the education side and the Department of Economy. And there was a lot of overlap and a lot of really, really useful and fruitful discussion came out of that.
I mean, that's really useful. Can I ask just another quick question? I don't want this to be a controversial question, but just a quick question. I mean, you're all about building, bringing communities together and building peace and all the rest of it. Have you had much kickback or applications for funding from anybody in regards to the Northern Ireland centenary, or have you stayed away from that hot potato?
No, we haven't, because probably because we have actually funded our, those plans are in place already.
Yes.
So, you know, that would be coming up in the next year, so that wouldn't be part of the current programme, and it probably would be before the next programme really starts, so we wouldn't be involved in that. But the councils, maybe in some of their work, might be doing some of that, and they could be using the action plan. You know, they've got a lot of very micro work going on, so they could be using some of the peace funds. But in terms of the larger projects, no, we haven't been involved.
That's okay. I got a side look from you, Chris. What was that about?
Hot potato.
Well, it is for some. You know what I meant. Stop it.
There's no better way to get your question heard than starting it with, I don't mean this to be controversial. Okay, I'm going to pass over now to Martina.
I wouldn't think of being controversial. you'll probably, from your end of the table, be glad to know the Orange Order did receive 3.6 million of European funding from the SEUPB. So it is an organisation that I know that in Europe is talked about widely, very fondly, because of the dedication that has been there to the peace funding.
You're not talking about the Order there.
Oh, definitely not. I would not say that. It would definitely be the SEUPB. And as an organisation, it is recognised across the EU for what we have achieved thus far. I'm a little bit concerned, Chair. I don't know if you're picking up any of this from the organisations who have for years secured European Social Fund, European Regional Development funding. And for many of them, I've heard them say, well, thankfully, we still have peace. And they feel that maybe peace four is an avenue for them. And I can imagine you are going to be overwhelmed with applications. So how comprehensive is the consultation process? I'm glad to hear, like the Chair, that you've said it's co-design.
Yeah.
Because there can be white communities without communities, so it should always be co-design. And you're saying it's a statutory consultation. But is there clarity there about what the six themes will be, so that it's not seen as a fund that's going to, because you will not be able to fill the gap of 3.6 billion? Of European funding that's going to be lost.
Yeah, I think it is clear, Martina, because the departments of economy who would have been responsible for both of those, you know, the site of the programme and also the ESF, have been working with us in the development of these themes. And I think there is a recognition from people who've been involved in ESF programmes that the peace programme is different because we do base it on, you know, the objectives of building positive relations and peace building. So the types of training, but we are going to have training projects within the Peace Plus programme because you can do both. And it'll be about how projects can show that they can do the relationship building along with the skills development, taking the opportunities, or indeed doing it on a cross-border basis with agencies in Northern Ireland and agencies in the border counties working together maybe on some of the training skills. So we have addressed that. We're very wary of it because a lot of people have said that. You know, oh, well, sure, we'll just go to the peace programme. But we're trying to modify it in such a way that it's... I mean, we obviously, as a peace programme, we have to deliver the objectives of peace building, but we can also deliver on investment and, you know, because obviously with peace goes prosperity, so we're taking the opportunities that we can to bring those areas into the programme. Is there anything, Declan, you want to...
I suppose just in terms of the consultation and how extensive it's been, I mean, as Gina's already outlined, we had a very extensive consultation process with communities and with our key stakeholders at the start of this year. You will have probably seen the kind of summary document as well, which was, again, an extensive piece of work from our point of view. All of that's fed in addition to the engagement we're having with the departments on a north-south basis, as well as the socioeconomic profile. And other kind of key research, all of that's fed into the development of these themes. And we will obviously then be proceeding to a public consultation as well. So we'll be going back out with this information in terms of the themes and the detail behind it to take people's views again in the next couple of months.
Can I ask another just one question about the multimodal hub in Derry that you talked about? Obviously, mm-hmm. expressing interest as an MLA from the city, and it was Interreg funding, 27 mm-hmm. million. And what we don't want is a white elephant because mm-hmm. the revenue is being mm-hmm. sought, it needs to take that forward. But given that was Interreg funding, and my understanding that peace and Interreg now is amalgamating. And
yeah, that's right.
So how is the amalgamation from Interreg and peace? How are you managing that within your organisation? Has there been, for instance, obviously you collaborate with anyway, but with the kind of skill sets that you would need for both programmes, is there any ensuring that those skill sets are still maintained and there's no loss of personnel because of the scale of the work that's going to be done across these six mm-hmm. programmes? People mm-hmm. need to understand about that amalgamation and yeah. my engagement with the community that's out there as much. I don't think people are as aware that these two standalone individual programmes will be amalgamated into one, and there's obviously consequences for them.
Yeah, well, the two programmes, we actually think it's a really good thing that the two programmes are being amalgamated, because the peace programme was built on peace building and relationships. The Interreg was very much on the economic focus, the territorial development aspect, and it was cross-border. Bringing the two together then means that there were projects that didn't quite meet the criteria for peace, but didn't quite meet it for Interreg either. And you could see that this project was, you know, would be beneficial to both, but didn't make it into either programme. So by bringing them together, it's allowed us to bring communities into being involved in particularly the area, say, of sustainable futures. So that's about climate change, and we're going to do that on the basis of when the communities are involved, it'll be the peace-building aspect, the relationship building. But on the larger projects, like the like of a sustainable transport, that will be maintained, again, the integrity of that through the Interreg programme, because it'll be cross-border. Because at the end of the day, you know, we would say that the two complement each other very well, because the Good Friday Agreement, the Belfast Agreement, is all about establishing links north, south, east, west. That's what we've been developed under, and that's what this programme will be able to carry on doing, bringing the two together. Internally, we've managed the two programmes, and so now, you know, bringing them together, we might end up with a larger programme. Yes, we might need some additional help with that and some additional experts. We're also looking at what we can do to help communities and applicants. So we're looking at simplification of the administrative processes. We're looking at bringing in pre-development support, maybe running more workshops and trying to help projects, because you know, what we're trying to do is develop a quality programme with quality projects. It's not in our interest to have a project that, you know, needs help. So we're going to try and put in that support to help them understand this a bit more. But I think the smaller projects, funds both in Theme 1 and Theme 6, will allow the communities to do either cross-community or cross-border in either of those themes, and so it should be a little bit clearer. And just a little point in relation to the sort of the ESF side again, what we're also trying to engender throughout every one of these themes is the area of social innovation and community innovation. So trying to encourage communities to actually become, you know, deal with some of their social challenges and sort of think big and think differently, whether it's about services, working with statutory agencies or the civil service. And in fact, a call we had in the current peace programme just closed yesterday or the day before, and that was to sort of, it's almost the pre-development to this programme, because it's about building capacity within communities for social innovation. So that's the whole area of social entrepreneurship, social economy, and the social enterprises, and all of that support for those areas as well.
Yeah, I think there's a process in place in the SEUPB that could be shared across departments, because when I was listening, you talk about how you overcommit, and yet we are faced with project after project, you know, infrastructure projects that they certainly, in terms of not overcommit, they undercommit, and then we end up, you know, there's millions needed as this project is coming to a close, or there's a threat of this project not going to be fulfilled, and yet you've been running program after program, overcommitting, always overshooting, and then coming in under the budget. So there's probably an experience and an expertise in your field that certainly can be shared with some of our officials in the department.
Is that done similarly to the sort of airplay and overbooking seats, that if you know that maybe sort of 5% of projects will apply and not make it, and therefore is it that?
It is, but I have to say the government departments take the risk of the overcommitment while we're overcommitted, you know, so because we work with all the government departments in all the different areas, and so we would have an agreement from the Department of Finance, North and South, to overcommit the programme, say up to 105%, because our, you know, our experience shows that the programme will always underspend by about 5 to 8%. So, I mean, what we're trying to do is make sure that Northern Ireland PLC and the Irish government get back 100% of this fund. So that's why we bring it then down. But if we ended up a little bit over then and spend over, and, you know, the government departments would actually, they do pick up the risk for us in that regard.
Okay, Trevor.
Yeah, thanks, Chair, and thanks for your presentation, Jane. I think the work that you do is fantastic.
You know? Thank you.
It really brings something to the party. It has over a number of years now, and I hope it can be continued on as successful a basis as it has been so far. Having said that, while you were speaking, I took about half a dozen notes here, and while the first three questioners were speaking, I crossed them all out because they covered it. So I don't really have a whole lot to ask you. You mentioned the small grants scheme. How small or how big are we talking about?
Well, we're doing a little bit of work at the minute, actually. We're just completing it on. We've been out doing a bit of research to see the types of projects that we might fund that would be wanted in the communities. So we're talking about probably under 100,000. And we could have a very small grants of, you know, in certain areas for a particular range of activity that could be, say, 5 to 10,000. You could have another range of activity, and that's the work that we're completing on at the minute, that could be, you know, the 30 to 50,000 type range, or, you know, and then up to 100,000. But there is options within the European regulations to do what are called simplified cost options, so that it reduces a lot of the bureaucracy in terms of verification of it. It becomes almost like a service that if you agree the outputs and the budgets with the project, and they can deliver and they come back and show you it's delivered, you can literally hand them a cheque. You don't have to go through all the, you know, the elaborate verification, which is a big help for smaller projects, and that's why we are very, very keen to bring that in.
Yeah, well, that aspect of it would be a godsend, because all the small grant schemes there ever has been, the difficulty in filling up the forms and trying to fulfil all the criteria has been the problem, and a lot of small applicants, I think, have just given up at some stage, and that's a pity, because their schemes could be valid. Okay, well, as regards to Peace Plus going forward, Is the funding for Peace Plus from 2021 to 2027 secure?
Yes. There's a commitment on the table, and therefore it's secure until I'm told otherwise.
And if the British government and Europe really fall out, as appears possible, would that affect it, or is it not conditional on a deal?
As I said, there's a commitment on the table, and until it's taken off the table, it's there. There's a commitment there. And to be fair, the UK government last January, when they announced it, they did actually say, regardless, deal or no deal, this commitment was there.
Up to 2027? I thought they talked about up to the existing schemes, up to 2022.
No, this was for the future, this Peace Plus programme. So they have given the commitment, but you know the money will be put into the programme, and that's the commitment that's been given.
That's another promise we have. Yes, here's the camera and size. It's a bit like fisheries. Thanks for that. That's grand. Thank you.
Okay, Christopher.
I think what you meant to say there, Trevor, was that if anyone's going to break it, it'll not be the UK government. Anyway, could I ask?
Like what I said was
in terms of the projects that you fund, what percentage of the budget generally goes on technical assistance?
6%.
That's excellent, because I in a previous life worked for an MEP, and at one point it was 12%. So if it's 6%, that's
6%. Yeah,
that's a very
I think maybe back at Peace One, 20 odd years ago, I think it might have been 9% or something, but it's 6%.
Okay, obviously we are moving to post Brexit era. You are the special European Union programmes body, but obviously one of the areas of potential work for you, I think, is in securing arrangements and investment effectively from the European Investment Bank for projects. I'm just wondering, has that been scoped out? And if you could talk to that even a wee bit?
Yeah, no, that hasn't been at all. Our statutory remit is delivery of these programmes.
Okay.
So that hasn't been discussed, and I'm sure maybe if that would be between...
Going forward,
that could be for the Departments of Finance to discuss that and look at that possibly.
So, yes, like a special European programmes body rather than European Union programmes body?
I don't know.
Because it's a periphery region of the European Union. I think that means we can access...
Yes, that's right.
...money from that... Okay. Just in terms of the figures you gave, 60 million committed from Europe, 28 million, was it, from ROI?
No, that's the additional money.
Additional money, yes.
So that would be a total of 120 and 87.
So the UK proportion of that should be... Remember, you said it hadn't been committed yet.
Well,
I was wondering...
The current commitment is the 60... from the EU, the 60 from Ireland, and the 300 million from the UK, and then that's matched by all the government departments to add on their element. But the additional money on the table is 120 from the EU and 87 from the Irish government, and I don't know. That's the bit that's under discussion.
The corresponding figure would be.
That's the bit that's under discussion, I think, between the UK and the EU.
Okay, one of the areas that I think is important, I think Martina touched upon it. Not criticisms, but one of the issues that I have had with a lot of government projects is, I think, for people, something that they can see with their own eyes, physically see, bricks and mortar, capital investment, is something that shows them the benefit of organisations like SEUPP, where revenue, I think, less so. And I'm just wondering what you envisage the relative balance being in terms of investment in capital as opposed to investment in revenue going forward in the next stage.
We don't really know what the balance will be, because we've written the programme in such a way to keep it quite flexible.
Yeah.
Obviously, to deal with and as flexible as you can, in that, because we have to show the European Commission and indeed the Northern Ireland Executive and the Irish Government that this is based on an evidence of need and the yes. data that we've gathered, and it's in line with the priorities for government. But we've written it in such a way to be flexible to deal with the aftermath and the socioeconomic problems that will result because of COVID and indeed also because of Brexit. So that we'll wait to see what comes forward in the project schemes, you know, as it unfurls, what might be required from the Ireland Northern Ireland Protocol, because I believe that there is opportunities there to protect what we have and indeed build on those. And to address some of the challenges. And those projects will come forward in this. And it could be the case in some of these areas that we wouldn't envisage, you know, say in the smart towns, cities and villages, we don't know yet how much of that will be capital.
Yes.
Because we're going to do a bit of research next year as well, because obviously these areas are so wide-ranging. What we don't want is just everybody to come in and say, looking for a smart town or village.
Yeah.
So we're going to do some work in three specific areas. One is those areas most badly affected by COVID, such as tourism. The other one is in the whole area of the social economy. And the third one is smart towns, cities and villages. So that we, hopefully by the end of next year, will have a sort of a pathway to show what investments would make the biggest impact yes. in the region.
Okay.
In Northern Ireland and the six border counties. And so it'll come out of that probably what element of this will be capital. But you can be sure that the shared spaces will be capital and the transport projects will be capital, and there'll be capital elements within all the environmental protection.
Yeah.
Less so probably in the healthcare side, but there could also be some capital in there because, as I said, we want to bring communities in there, and particularly we want to look at well-being of communities, and that might be, you could be looking at potentially
community hubs and stuff
like
that.
Yeah, like, you know, drugs or rehabilitation centres or something that's yes. done on a cross-border, cross-community basis, that type of thing. So we just don't know yet the exact proportion. Sorry, Christopher, we don't.
You know, that's okay. The final question then. You know yourself, Martina made reference to it, my favourite EU project, the House of Orange. Single identity work is important because for communities to reach out to each other, they have to be confident in themselves. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I'm just wondering, in terms of empowering communities mm-hmm. to reach out, I appreciate and understand, obviously, your focus. It's not going to be a majority of where you're driving towards, but what elements do you see in terms of single identity work in the projects going forward?
Yeah, I totally agree with you. It's very important. And it's in that empowering communities area where there could be some, there is provision for single identity work that will lead on to cross-community work.
Yes.
So it'll almost be like a little bit of a, like pilot work. And indeed, so in that area and also potentially in theme six
yes.
in relation to challenges and, you know, maintaining and forging relationships, we do see, and building positive relationships, we do see a necessity for some single identity work, but obviously only if it's leading on to cross-community
work.
But I totally agree it is important, and I think there's a lot of people now who would like to do some work and they just don't maybe know how to go about it.
Yes.
So again, that's another piece of work we want to do next year, with maybe we're just looking at how best to deliver that, to do some of that capacity building and single identity work.
I think that is particularly an issue in the community that I come from.
Yes.
In terms of the community capacity
yes.
and skills and all of that infrastructure that is so important to yes. strengthen people to then reach out. And so I'm glad to hear that. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And a good heart way back to youth work days from the 80s and 90s about doing that pre
Yes.
You know, that single identity work was always a critical building block in moving forward. You want to come just on the back of something?
It's a very quick one, Chair. Thanks again. You mentioned about regeneration, town centres, and a particular emphasis on trying to preserve rather than demolish. Do you do any work alongside the Heritage Lottery Fund?
No, we don't actually. Up to now, we haven't really done much with the Heritage Lottery. One
a little
two,
bit,
just,
yeah,
just
a little
one or two,
bit
not
in the
much.
Past. Probably not so much not in this programme period.
Yeah, but maybe that'll be something going forward.
It could be, because it's one of the quirks of this country that there are certain organisations that won't actually take money from the lottery fund.
Yes, I know that, yeah.
Churches, but some churches will and some won't.
That's right, yeah.
So maybe they would quite happily take yours.
Yes, maybe they would, yeah.
Or even lottery money that was Channel 3.
And within that area of the, I mentioned earlier on, the empowering communities and the institutional capacity building, that includes, you know, politicians, churches, political groups, community groups. But it, we really do believe that there is single identity work that's required here.
Okay, thank you.
It was amiss of me not to mention as well that we have members that are actually on Starleaf that are on at the side, and so therefore it's not that we're depleting in numbers and we've Trevor here. So sometimes I don't get around. Is there anything I can bring you on? I'll just check on Starleaf, just in the order that I saw people joining. So Pat, is there anything that you would like to ask?
No, I'm okay, Chair, thank you.
Okay, and then I saw George next. Then George, is there anything that you want to ask? Going on lip reading, and I think he said, no, he's okay. I think he went from that. Okay, Emma, is there anything that you wanted to check out?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, go on ahead, yes.
No, it was just following on from the question that Trevor had asked there around the guarantee for Peace Plus, because obviously we've been working on the basis that Peace Plus would be getting another run again in the 2021 to 27, I think it is. That was, as I understand it, that was a commitment in terms of the cohesion policy, it was called, and it was accounted for within the withdrawal agreement. But we don't have, I suppose you answered that very carefully there, we don't actually have concrete confirmation that that can still be reneged on, can't it?
Well, as I said, it's a commitment we have at the minute. So I and the Department of Finance are working closely with the Northern Ireland office in relation to confirming when that will be actually confirmed, or indeed to the quantum that will be confirmed.
No, I know, and I appreciate, I suppose, from your perspective, and this, I'm not trying to challenge you guys. I know you are working on the programme and can only deal with the information that is in front of you. I just suppose it's probably challenging from your perspective that you're trying to account for a programme that we don't actually have cast iron guarantees on, and you know, at any point the rug could be pulled under us on that. I know in our pack as well we have correspondence from the Finance Minister. We still don't have any update on the shared prosperity funding from the British government in terms of what the replacement will be to the structural funding that we've seen from the EU up until this point.
That's right. That's not something we deal with, but I know Department of Finance are dealing with that, I think. Yeah.
It's just, I suppose it's worth highlighting, all of this is up in the air, and it can seem quite abstract when we're talking about it in committee in terms of, you know, there's all these different acronyms and all these different names of funding programmes. But when you're in your community, I know I sit on the RDP board in Mid Ulster, and the number of local community groups that have benefited from this funding, be it, you know, GAA clubs, Orange Halls, you've got different community association groups, play schools, the list goes on and on. So it will have real life implications on the ground. And I know in the pack some of the conversations that you touched on around like the border infrastructure and fears that people have around that. And obviously at one time this funding was seen as sort of the sweetener to, you know, some of the infrastructure that was there, and to try and ease division. And I suppose it's just a very real fear that we're going backwards. But thank you very much for the presentation and for the information you've provided there. Thank
you. Okay, and I think Emma actually has nicely brought us around, thank you, in a full circle there, because it goes right back to that bit at the beginning that we were saying, that it absolutely cuts across every facet of community life, mm-hmm. Within Northern Ireland, and that the funding is so important. And maybe just to of note rather than anything else for a comment, we met the last 2 weeks with the 11 councils on the issue of Brexit. Mm-hmm. I suppose if there was a recurring theme from each one of those councils, it was that they really fear for the future of those projects that they deliver in association with yourselves. And I suppose it would be fair to say that we got that palpable sense of fear that there is in the local government sector, that if they were to simply lose the ability to deliver those projects, it would have a major ramification on people's lives and on the delivery of community life. And also that there would be a series of jobs that you know, right across, and the amount of jobs that people are employed via EU funding is massive. So we've heard the commitments from various sources that the money will be replaced and that the tap won't be turned off. But I think it's critical for ourselves and the Executive Office and our ministers to absolutely be keeping that pressure on for clarity so that people can know exactly what's going to happen going forward. Can I thank both of you for your attendance here today? It's a very interesting piece of work, and as I say, you know, you're doing great work on the ground, and we really support and endorse all that you're doing. And thank you for making yourselves available today to present this.
Thank you very much.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
And members, I'll ask people just to take their ease for a few minutes while we prepare the room for the next session. So. Just before members take their ease, maybe. That there was a departmental oral evidence session on EU funding has been scheduled with officials from the Executive Office and the Department of Finance on the 9th of December. Now, there is a cross-cutting nature of the Peace Plus programme, and due to that, the Committee of Finance has agreed to coordinate the scrutiny of the programme across Assembly committees. Therefore, members, I'm suggesting that we forward any comments on the Peace Plus programme that we've received from today to the one on the 9th of December, but we'll pass those on to the Finance Committee. So members in agreement with that?
Great.
Yep.
Okay. And we'll take a few minutes of a break just while we prepare the room.
This is the...
So, okay, members, glad that we're back again. We're going to move on to item 5, which is the Victims Payment Scheme and oral evidence session from departmental officials. On pages 63 to 82 of the meeting pack are the relevant papers, and also on page 3 of the table pack is the departmental briefing. So we will welcome our guests. There we go. You're very welcome.
Yeah.
We have 2 seats available there. So we're welcoming, as usual, for the Victims Payment Scheme, Mark Brown, Director of Strategic Policy, Equality and Good Relations, and Gareth Johnson, the Director of Victims and Survivors Division in the Executive Office. As ever, evidence is being recorded by Hansard and will be published on the committee webpage. And we'll just go for the usual format of if you're going to give us a short presentation or update on where we are, and then we will open out the floor for some questions. So.
Certainly, Chair.
We're well used to the format.
Thank you very much. Yes, I think we're well into the format by now. Can I firstly apologise for the fact that the paper wasn't provided in advance within the time frame. But I will take you through the content of the the paper, which is really an update on our progress since the last meeting. So we've had the formal designation of the Department of Justice. And funding of 2.5 million advanced by the Executive Office, which has meant that a substantial programme of work has been able to be taken forward to put in place the Troubles Permanent Disablement Scheme. So that has already enabled the establishment of a dedicated project team in the Executive Office to oversee the programme of work to deliver the scheme. Likewise, the establishment of a dedicated project team in the Department of Justice to progress the development of the delivery structures that they are responsible for in relation to the scheme. It's also allowed critical IT developments to start. So the IT discovery phase, as it's described, has now been completed. And it's anticipated that progress will now move into the design phase for the system. Draft application forms for the scheme and accompanying guidance notes have been developed. And will be shared with the judge designated by the Lord Chief Justice and also with representatives of the victims and survivors sector. The Lord Chief Justice has announced Mr Justice McAlinden as the interim president of the Victims Payments Board to assist the Department of Justice with the development of the scheme. Job descriptions for the Victims Payment Board members have been finalised. And the Northern Ireland Judicial Appointments Commission, NIJAC, will be commencing the selection process for the short-term board members. And there's good progress that has been made on identifying accommodation for staff who will be delivering the new scheme. The funding advanced by the Executive will also enable a number of other important operational steps to advance the implementation of the scheme. And that includes work towards development of an online application system and associated security accreditation. The scoping and development work on the medical assessment process. Obviously, the payment of salaries and the IT requirements for the various project teams, the Victims Payments Board and the supporting administrative body. Provision of additional resources for the Victims and Survivors Service, VSS, and the VSS partner organisations to help them to train staff to ensure that they can support applicants through the applications process. Design and implementation of a staff training programme. Completion of independent reviews of the programme to provide an assessment of confidence for delivery. These are the gateway reviews and so forth that are carried out just to assess progress and whether or not the project's on target. Provision of the Government Actuary Department, or GAD, advice on the projected lifetime costs of the scheme. Provision of legal advice and on terms and conditions of contracts and procurement advice and services from construction and procurement delivery, CPD. It will allow also initial advertising around the opening of the scheme. So in terms of the timeline, Chair, if we maybe turn to that, the Justice Minister has indicated to the Assembly that her aim is for the scheme to open to applications in early March. An interim president, as I mentioned, has been appointed, and it's anticipated that the interim board members will be appointed in January 2021, with staff being put in place to support the board from February 2021. And subject to the establishment and agreement of the board, then the application forms, the guidance notes and so forth will be finalised, and the advice and support arrangements will be introduced for applicants by the end of January 2021. There's also, of course, important internal processes required. So the required business cases are progressing, and all approvals are expected to be in place and funding for 2021-22 secured by the end of February. An oversight group is in place, which I chair, and that monitors all aspects of implementation and timelines, including the development of the relevant business cases. There's work ongoing in relation to the lifetime cost of the scheme, and we've engaged the Government Actuary Department to assist in these calculations, and they aim to have produced revised estimated lifetime costs by mid to late December. An interim business case for the preparatory work that we've talked about before, the £2.5 million, has been drafted and is before the Department's Major Business Case Committee. A strategic outline case is at an advanced draft stage, and an outline business case, an overall outline business case with more detailed estimates, will be required further down the track. The number of applications to the scheme, as we've discussed at the committee before, and the related cost is unknown. And so costs are based on a range of assumptions relating to how many people will apply, what the average award might be, and how many people may avail of the lump sum option. And the estimates and costs will be subject to refinement as the scheme progresses. There are procurement processes that need to be followed in respect of the IT and the medical assessment service provider. And in relation to IT, it's anticipated that what's described as a minimum viable product, in other words, the basic system needed to allow us to open the scheme, will be in place for the scheme opening to applications in early March. And discussions are ongoing in relation to procurement of the, in relation to identification of the medical assessment service provider. Once the scheme is open, it'll take some time to process applications. So DOJ have advised that it's not possible to be specific, therefore, about when exactly payments to victims and survivors might commence, as that will ultimately be a matter for the Victims Payments Board when it's established. It will also depend on how quickly the necessary evidence can be gathered and the medical assessments carried out, if they're required, to allow the applications to be assessed. In terms of future funding, which of course has been an ongoing issue, both the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister are entirely committed to delivering the scheme. And TEO acknowledges that the scheme needs to be funded in order to operate properly. In accordance with the normal government budgeting arrangements, TEO will make a request for the necessary funding to allow it to make the necessary grants of funding to DOJ for the scheme in accordance with paragraph 9 of Schedule 1 of the regulations with the Department of Finance. And we will make those bids to the Department of Finance as the funding falls due, so in other words, as it's required. In other words, a request will be made before each budget period for the resources that are anticipated to be required during that period, and that's in line with normal budgeting processes. Alongside this, the First Minister and Deputy First Minister along with the Finance Minister and the Justice Minister, will continue to seek additional funds for the block grant from the Secretary of State and, through him, the Treasury, to address the financial pressures created by the scheme. The four ministers met on the 22nd of September to discuss the approach to substantive funding and have agreed to seek a meeting with the Secretary of State. Now, those discussions and requests will not prevent TEO in the meantime from making the necessary requests for funding from the Department of Finance as they fall due. However, despite the meeting being requested on the 22nd of September, as of the 12th of November, the actual arrangements have not yet been agreed. Correspondence has recently been received from the Secretary of State indicating that he's willing to meet. In that correspondence, the Secretary of State reiterated the position that victims' payments is a devolved matter, and devolved matters are funded by the block grant, and that the devolved funding mechanism means that the executive is funded through the block grant, together with its own revenue-raising capabilities, in order to fund its statutory responsibilities, including the victims' payment scheme. And so he states it's therefore for the executive to manage its available resources to deliver its spending priorities. DOF has already commissioned an exercise to gather information from departments on their provisional budget requirements over the next 3 years, from 2021 to 2024. And consistent with our indication that we would seek the necessary funding as it falls due, TEO has included the following indication of its requirements for the victims' payment scheme in its formal response. And that's been agreed by the First Minister and Deputy First Minister and submitted to the Department of Finance. So for the first year, 2021-22, a bid of $28.7 million has been put forward. For the second year, 2022-23, $64.3 million. The third year, 2023-24, $72 million. So that makes a total of $165 million over those 3 years. On the initial scoping of the cost for 2021, the expectation by DOJ and TEO was that $2.5 million should be sufficient to cover the costs incurred by both departments in undertaking the necessary work to establish the scheme's administrative arrangements. As the project has developed and costs have been refined, it's now expected that some additional funding may be required. So TEO and DOJ officials are currently looking at the detailed costings, and we will include any additional funding needs that might be identified within 2021 as part of our return on the departmental January monitoring round. But sure, that's an update on where we are, timeline, funding and so forth. Happy to take any questions.
Mark, thanks very much for the presentation and the detail there. And I suppose if we compare all of that to maybe where we were even 6 months ago, there's been a considerable amount of movement, and that has to be very welcome, because we've always consistently highlighted from this committee how those within the victims community are some of those that require most of our attention. And it feels like over the last number of years, they've received the least of our attention. And there is an urgency about delivering this scheme, and they will want to see that scheme delivered. The unfortunate side to this is that there is obviously some form of fiscal management that needs to be considered as part of this. And I think that we are still looking at a scenario where that is deeply worrying. And I can't quite determine in my own mind whether the Secretary of State is just disinterested, or whether he lacks an understanding, or whether it's a negotiating tack to simply say, no, this is just simply something to do with yourselves. And without overplaying or underplaying the specifics, the British government was a player in the troubles process that there was here that resulted in the victims' community, and therefore to completely absent themselves of any responsibility for having to pick up the tab at the other end, I think is quite naive. And I think it's something that they will really have to consider. And I hope that they will enter into any meetings or negotiations with the executive in an open and positive way, and that it isn't simply to say, no, this is nothing to do with us. And likewise, there are a number of people from the victim sector that aren't from Northern Ireland. They're not from here. They weren't injured here. And there obviously is a consideration that needs to be given to them as well, and how they are featured into any pension system that goes forward. So it is still a very perilous scenario, given that. And I offer that more as a comment than a question, because I appreciate that you're not going to have an answer to that until there is a conclusion of the that programme. Maybe can I just ask, would you have any sense at this stage that if the programme rolls out in March, what sort of numbers of people might be able to avail of the scheme and how quick it will take that scheme to build a bit of steam to start delivering for a significant number of people? Is there any thoughts about how many will get included in that process as we move forward?
Well, we've had some discussion before, Chair, about the actual... There's two questions really in that, which is one, what is the total numbers that will come forward, and then how quickly can they be processed? Mm-hmm. In terms of the total numbers, we're still working on that. We had the initial NIO estimate of 2,000, which was the basis of the earlier costings. Now, we now believe that to be much, much too low. On the basis of work we're doing with Queen's University on psychological injuries, and also consideration of how many service personnel, both police and army, both here and in GB, who may be eligible for this scheme, we find the numbers could be significantly higher than 2,000. But in assessing what our budgetary requirements might be over the next 3 years, what we've looked at is what is the likely throughput, assuming that there's a significant number that come forward, regardless of the other number, assuming a significant number come forward, what's the likely throughput? And we've looked at that in light of our experience with the Historical Institutional Abuse Tribunal, which is a very similar sort of process in terms of a judge-led board and so forth. And on the basis of three panels sitting for 4 days a week, which is what happens in HIA, we have reckoned on a throughput in the first year perhaps of somewhere in the region of 500 cases, the second year 1,200 cases, and the third year 1,200 cases. So approaching 3,000 over the first three years. And that's been the basis on which we have calculated the sums that we've asked for from the Department of Finance. Now, clearly, ultimately, how many cases are dealt with will be a matter for the actual payments board to decide itself. It will also be dictated by the extent to which all the evidence they need can be quickly gathered, how quickly people actually apply, and how complicated the assessments actually are. But we've looked to the only reasonable comparator we have, which is the HIA, and based our assumptions around that.
And you would hope that even in what you've just said there would enlighten the British government to what they need to do here, insofar as they're basing their modelling on 2,000 cases, and you reckon in the first 3 years that you'll get 3,000 through, and this will be a process that will probably go on for many years beyond that. So, I mean, it's fairly obvious to most that the numbers that are going to be involved in the scheme is going to well outweigh the NIO's figures, and they're even saying no to any financial support at 2,000, never mind that it's going to be more. So I hope that that will allow a sharpening of thought for people there to realise that the block grant that we have here, you know, it's virtually committed in keeping the lights on, and not much more to be on it. But to start heaping this sort of pressure on is just unfair.
I think it's important just to make the point, Chair, that the scheme's application should be made within the first 5 years. Okay. And then there's some time after that. Obviously, it'll take a little bit longer to actually consider them all. Mm-hmm. A number of them will seek lump sums, so it'll really be a single payment. But there will be others who will seek the ongoing payment, and that will go on. That element will go on for a great many years, in the same way as a pension scheme might go on in different circumstances.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to pass to Doug.
Thanks, Chair. Thanks for the brief. I mean, it's always good to get what's happening in changes. If I can just sort of carry on with the commentary about this, I mean, I'm absolutely clear that I believe the UK government should help with the financial support for this scheme. But I don't think the UK government has just turned their backs on the victim scheme. I mean, I've got to remind people, the only reason the UK government brought this in is because we failed to. It's because we are the ones who failed in the first place, and the British government had to step up to bring this in. So I don't think they washed their hands of it. I think it was a disgrace that we couldn't sort it out, that they had to do it for us. But they do need to add financial support to that. And when we do say that the British government has got responsibility, so what happened here? As the Chair would say, they were a player in this conflict. Well, so was the Irish government a player in this conflict. And I don't see them putting their hands in their pockets too much or making any movement towards supporting this whatsoever. So there is a commentary to be had about this whole thing. And I do believe the UK government does have to put the hand in their pocket and put money in to support this, but so do other people. And the sooner we sort of get on with this, the better. Can I just raise an issue about the numbers, please? Because I was part of this process for quite some while back, as were others, and it was working through the VSS, and they started off with about 150 people who were likely to get this payment, and that went up to about 750 people, and now they were talking about 2,000, and now we're talking about 3,000 in these numbers. But is there not a case about the management of expectation? Because even now we're sitting here calling this a victim's payment scheme, and it's not a victim's payment scheme. It's a troubles permanent disability payment scheme. So what you've got out there now is you've got people out there who are victims. Rightly, they're victims who think they're entitled to this because they are victims. That's not what it's designed for. It is designed for permanent disabilities. And if we can stop and change our language, and I'm looking at all the paperwork which comes from yourselves and elsewhere, and it's using victims payment scheme, we need to change our language, and it needs to be troubles permanent disability payment scheme. And that makes people understand that this is for people from the troubles with permanent disabilities. And that might be a reason why our numbers are sort of increasing. Is that a fair point?
Well, I think in the first thing, you're absolutely right that we need to get the terminology correct. It needs to do what it says in the tin, and that's really important. So using the term the permanent disablement scheme is really important. Remember, this started as a victim's pension. We've tried to get away from it.
Oh, I know, yeah.
A pension then became payment, and now using the full term, I think, is important to convey what the scheme is actually designed to do. And in terms of where the increase in the numbers has come from, I mean, initially the commitment was around the severely physically disabled. And then, and that's what the initial discussions were all about. Then this extended into those who were permanently disabled from a psychological perspective, and it's in trying to assess the psychological damage really here and the numbers that might come forward in that area where the real difficulty is. I think we're probably fairly clear about how many people have suffered severe physical disability. Most of them are already being supported by the VSS, and the figures there are accurate. When you get to psychological disability in terms of those who are being supported by VSS, our estimate is, based, as I say, on the work of a psychiatrist in Queens and other information and surveys about how many people have suffered psychological or mental illness or disability through the Troubles, that the figures are much, much higher than were initially envisaged. But the problem is, it's difficult to know exactly how many there are and how many will then come forward and how many will meet the threshold for that. So that is where the increase has come in. And that's one aspect, those who are here in the civilian aspect. Then when you look at the services aspect and the numbers who were service personnel who were who suffered a permanent disability as a consequence of their service here, we can get numbers for those that are resident here, but we can't distinguish from all of those who are receiving a pension over in GB, how many are receiving that as a consequence of the troubles here. Now, I suppose you could speculate that the likelihood is that there could be fairly significant numbers, given that the campaign here the operation here was one of the biggest in the British Army history. But we still don't know how many numbers there are there. And the issue there is that while it's unlikely the individuals themselves would be receiving any payment from this, on their death, they could nominate, provided they've applied beforehand, they could nominate for a spouse or a carer to actually receive the 10 years' worth of payment. That's where a great amount of this unknown is coming in. We're trying to work that through. We've been in touch with the MOD on this, but it's been difficult to get any clarity around those figures, and they have the potential to significantly increase the numbers that we're talking about.
But those, thanks for Mark, that makes sense. And I'll just say something to you. You see that increase for psychological? That's where the jump went from on the VSS when I was with them from 750 to 2,000, was because we suddenly went, oh, psychological. Well, that's where the jump initially came from. I'm not saying we're expanding something here. I absolutely get the problem that we're talking about. But are we saying then, because those people who are service personnel will be directed to the MOD's scheme, and that's where they should go to for their compensation, not to this scheme. You know, if it's a permanent disability due to their service within the military here in Northern Ireland, then it's the MOD he will be who will be paying them, not this scheme.
Well, there's two things. First of all, I think the jump in the psychologically disabled wasn't just by including those that were known to VSS, because they wouldn't actually know everyone in Northern Ireland. It's only those that happen to be in contact. Yeah. So there's an increase there when you start doing population estimates of how many would be impacted there, so that increases the numbers. And then the issue about the MOD and those who have been service personnel is that while they go, yes, to their own scheme, they are eligible for this scheme. Now, any payments they get in relation to the MOD scheme are discounted, so it probably isn't beneficial for them in the main, but on their death, if they have applied and deemed to be eligible, there would be 10 years worth of provision available for their spouses and for their carers, and that's where this could become very attractive, and that's where the additional cost could come in, and that's what we've been looking at here.
Yeah, I might, Mark, just add something on the name of the scheme and making sure that the nature of the scheme is understood, because that's something that the sector is very concerned about as well, and it's been the topic of a number of our meetings. Unfortunately, the regulations that we've inherited talk in two different ways about this. They say the troubles. Permanent Disablement Payment Scheme, but they also talk about a Victims Payment Board. What DOJ colleagues have been doing is to try and make sure that in the branding, the Troubles Permanent Disablement Scheme comes out very clearly, because the last thing we want to do is for people to feel that this is something they might benefit from and then be disappointed. That's just going to be re-traumatising for
them. I know, absolutely right, guys. And that's the problem, because I'm getting it in my constituency office. I'm getting people coming in who were victims, and they were victims without a shadow of a doubt. But and it's really hard to say to them, but you're not permanently, it's not a permanent disability, you're not entitled. It's really quite difficult. But that's something that I have to manage. But the beauty about being in this committee and in the Justice Committee is that I know that the DOJ are saying, let's make sure we use the right terminology, and that's one of the reasons why I read it. But I mean, your answers are perfectly right and acceptable. I have no issue at all with that. What was said as well, though, and I know you haven't said this, Mark, I'm sorry, Chair, I'll make this my last one. What was said, Mark, and I know you haven't said it, but DOJ staff said that the first payment is likely to be at the end of the financial year 21-22. So we're talking payment in March-April of 22. That seems an awful long way away.
Well,
I think that what was said was maybe that the second half of the financial year, the 21-22 financial year. But it really depends on how quickly the processes can be worked through. I mean, there is a multi-stage process here. So first of all, people gather together their evidence, get in their application. Then a decision needs to be made about eligibility. Was it a troubles-related incident? Was the person present in the immediate aftermath? And the board will need to go and check some records, maybe police records, maybe health service records, to be able to triangulate that and establish it. Then if you get through that, there's the question of what is the degree of disability. So there's an assessment that needs to be done there. So the regulations do give us quite an elongated process. Now, I know that DOJ colleagues are committed to working things through as quickly as they can. It may be that there are cases which where people have the information all there and conveniently to hand, and in fact there is provision. There is provision for prioritisation within the regulations. So I think they will be doing everything they can to get cases through, but there is just a time factor here that can't be avoided.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm not trying to put a thumb on somebody and say, give us a time, it's got to be to this time. I get that. But again, it's an expectation as well. You know, somebody says, you know, the fourth quarter of the financial year, you know, it's worth, you know, understanding what we're talking about here, because the HIA didn't take that long to get it out. They got it out within 4 months. They had their first payments going out within 4 months of it being set up. You know, but we're talking we're talking twice, maybe three times that. So, but you know, like I said, I'm not trying to put my thumb on a date. I'm just trying to get an understanding of it.
Well, I think as Gareth said, there may be some cases that may be able to come forward more quickly, and I suspect what our colleagues are trying to do is again to manage expectations that, but the main flow is maybe going to take some time to get into place. There may be some early ones that can come through, and the HIA process, while it's similar, is not exactly the same as this one. There are some additional complications, I think, in this scheme which could lead to slightly longer time frames and consideration.
Okay, thank you.
Okay,
patience, Chair.
Going to go to Pat now to come in next.
Yes, thank you, Chair, and thanks, Mark and Gareth, for coming in again. First of all, I think we're all in agreement that the sooner those who have been disabled as a result of the conflict receive this payment, then the better. And all of us want to see that happening as quickly as possible. However, we all know there are some anomalies in this scheme, and I'll focus on the anomalies around the funding. And I don't expect you, Mark, to have the answers to this, but I want to mention it anyway. And usually in circumstances like this, whoever makes the policy also provides the funding. And of course, it was the British government who developed the policy. And now they're saying they're not going to provide the funding, that it's going to have to come out of the block grant. The other issue is that I know of no other circumstance where devolved administration would have to pay for a scheme that would cover all the jurisdictions as well as Europe, anyone who had been injured in Europe. So, I mean, there are clear anomalies in this, and I think all of us are in agreement that the British government need to stump up as far as this scheme is concerned. So I'm just wondering, first of all, I listened to what you said about the British Secretary of State's letter effectively saying it was up to the executive to find the funding. And I know he hasn't been terribly forthcoming when it comes to sitting down to have a discussion about providing any funding. But I'm wondering, has any discussions taken place at official level that you're aware of, Mark, between yourselves and the NIO?
Well, we would be in contact, Pat, with the NIO in some aspects, sometimes just trying to clarify the policy intent, for example, or again in contact with them about where we can go to get information, for example, about the number of service personnel and so forth. But the issues that you're describing really are entirely in the political sphere and are ones for ministers to take forward. And the First and Deputy First Minister are clear that they believe that the British government should be making a contribution to this scheme. And they have indicated, along with the Justice Minister that and the Finance Minister, that they want to pursue that, and they're seeking to pursue that. But as I say, these issues are very much in the political sphere and are not ones that officials would be able to sort out.
And I understand that. I suppose my fear is around the sustainability of this scheme, because I think you've said before it could go on for potentially 30 years. And, there was a discussion there earlier, Doug mentioned it, about service, our British service personnel qualifying for this in terms of nominating a spouse for 10 years payment after their death. And we've had some informal discussion around this within the committee. And, it's difficult to quantify how... what size of a claim would result out of British Army personnel making that particular application, because presumably many of the people who would be making an application are already in receipt of a disabled pension from the Ministry of Defence. But it wouldn't be a lot of trouble to make an application then, because all the evidence would be already there with the Ministry of Defence. And these things have a tendency to snowball, I have mentioned before in relation to the PSNI hearing loss claim. Once it appears that, a small number of people are getting claims for what is effectively a subjective injury, and that would be the case in regard to psychological injuries. So you could have a considerable avalanche of claims for people, particularly, as I say, with psychological injuries. So, I mean, that's another issue that makes the issue of who's going to pick up the tab for this. And, I mean, I suppose a lot of people might say that, well, the executive should have no difficulty providing, you know, the first couple of years of funding for this. But I mean, it's a bit like going for a mortgage and you bring 3 months' pay slips with you. But I mean, a decision is taken by the mortgage company of whether they think you're able to sustain the payments over a much longer period of time into the future, you know, whether it's 20, 25 years or whatever. And it seems to me there would be difficulty for the executive in sustaining the funding for this over a protracted period, particularly if there was, as I say, an avalanche of claims from British Army personnel. What would your view on that be?
Well, at the moment, Pat, we're working to get the best estimate we can. I'm not actually sure we're going to be able to get a very accurate estimate around this area. It's very, very difficult because there's a number of things that impact. The first thing is, while we know the number of British Army personnel in receipt of pension in GB, and it's around 100,000, we don't know how many of those were as a consequence of the Troubles. The point you made about the evidence being there, that if you are eligible for that pension, you may be eligible for this scheme, it depends on the evidence levels and what criteria they are. They wouldn't be exactly the same in both. Then there's the issue about how attractive is this permanent disablement scheme compared to whatever benefits or whatever ongoing payments there would be to the widow of a member of service personnel. Then there's the issue about, even if it's attractive, how many would come forward, because we know not everybody in every case is going to come forward. So there's a whole series in there of very, very difficult assumptions to make. And the difficulty is, when you're making an assumption and dividing it into a large number, a small variation leads you to a very large figure. So I think this area is going to be particularly difficult, and for us to come up with any sort of meaningful estimate. We've got as far as we can, I think, almost with the MOD. We've been talking to them. Their database is limited as to what it can tell us. So this is going to be an area of very significant uncertainty.
Okay. Thanks, Lord. Thank you, Mark.
Okay. Trevor?
Thanks, Chair. Thanks, Chair. Thank you, Martin. Garth. At least you're making good progress on the organisational side of this, that's for sure, and that's good to see. But the elephant in the room, obviously, is funding, and we all keep coming back to this. The three figures you've given us for the 21, 22 and so on, I know that's somebody's best guess based on various criteria. Now, would it be fair to say that those figures are more related to lump sum payments than pension payments, or is that not the case?
Well, I mean, Gareth can give the detail on that one, but where we come up with those figures was on the basis that we consider that the likely number of people eligible are going to be significantly more than 2,000.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, and you start looking at, well, what's the sort of physical capacity of the panel to actually process payments? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And again, looking to the HIA as an example. Now, of course, you can flex that up or down by bringing in more panels. That creates its own problems. You have to bring in more admin support, and you have to try and process all the evidence. But the figures that we've put in place are what we think is a reasonable sort of throughput for the first 3 years, and that's what we've based that on. Now, we do expect that a significant number of people are likely to go for the lump sum up front. Gareth, do you want to say a little bit more about some of the considerations around that?
Yes. The lump sum is available to people who are 60 or over, or who turn 60 or over. Now, the question is, how many people who fall into that category would want to take the lump sum rather than the annual payments? we have been working on the basis that it will be an attractive option for people. And we're looking at maybe between two-thirds and four-fifths of people who would take that option. But just to give, by way of illustration, if we took, say, year three there, the 72 million figure that's in the papers that you have, now these figures are hedged around with all kinds of cautions, but about 40 million of that would be backdating, because people get their claims backdated to the Stormont House Agreement 2014. About 18 million, the lump sums, and then 7 million or so the annual payments with the implementation costs on top of that. So the backdating and the lump sums, at least in the early stage, are where we're envisaging the bulk of the money is going to go.
You know, I would think the over 60s that you talk about, the question of whether they would take a lump sum or a pension really depends on their age. If they're 70 plus, they'd probably take a lump sum. But I'm wondering also, Mark, you mentioned the five-year window for applications. I have no experience with this. That seems like an awful long time for something that has been in the making for so long that most people, let's say a lot of people who might be eligible for these payments would already know about it and would be waiting to go. And I think you're going to find out next March just what the likely uptake is going to be, I think. Do we need to spread the application process over that length of time? I think you even said there might be exceptions to that that would go into the future beyond 5 years.
Well, no, what I was saying was it might take longer to actually make a decision on some of the applications. But in those 5 years, there'll be a tail of a period before, as you're still working through all the applications you get in the 5 years. The 5 years were set down in the regulations.
All right. Okay.
So that was part of the framework that we have to work within. I think for some people will be very aware of the scheme and very aware of whether they're eligible or not. I think there will be others who will be less aware. And this provides an opportunity to ensure that there's an opportunity for people to be made aware of the scheme, for publicity about it, and so that if they feel that they're entitled, they are able to apply and they're encouraged to apply.
There's also the factor that if someone has had a traumatic experience, the making the decision to apply and the taking the steps to apply, the getting information and so on, may be things that you have to work yourself up to. So I think that was part of the consideration. But the 5 year application period was the same as for the historical institutional abuse scheme.
Okay. Do you think that the third year here is a very high figure? Yeah. What would your best guess be after that? Because this thing is going to run for, as Pat said, I think for 30 years, possibly. It must taper off.
Well, that's part of the calculations. How many applications will come forward? What will the level of assessment be, based on the degree of disablement? How many will take the lump sum up front? That all plays into the figures that we have. And then once we get beyond the sort of 5, 6, 7 year period, you would expect that it's those who are taking the ongoing pension or ongoing payment. Over the number of years that we're talking about, and that figure will gradually, decline over the years.
But do you think? Sorry about that, Chair.
Yeah, I know it's descending a wee bit into a conversation down in that corner of the room. Can we try and keep it to a question and answer?
Just a one then. I mean, is it fair to say that the vast majority of the applications will come in inside the 5 years? That there shouldn't be people left out after that point in time? And then you could accurately quantify the extent of funding required. On the basis of these figures, there's no way that the Northern Ireland Exchequer can deal with this. The British government obviously has to come in. So I'm interested in Mr. Lewis's strident response. There's no way that they will come in. And he says he'll meet about it, but he then goes on to say we're not going to budge. This is negotiation, all right.
Well, applications have to be submitted within the 5 years. Obviously, as we move through the process, we'll get a better idea of the extent to which there's a significant number of applications coming in and whether or not the estimates that we had are accurate or not. And we will revise, as is good practice, we will revise our estimates and our business cases in light of that.
What I'm thinking is that as time goes on, let's say after the 10-year point and beyond that, that the Northern Ireland budget could probably handle it, I would have thought. But these 3 years, and possibly a couple of years beyond those 3 years, where the pressure will be and the almost impossibility of us being able to deal with it.
Well, the provisions for backdating and the provisions for lump sums mean that a lot of the costs are front-end loaded.
And thank you very much. Thanks, Chair.
And apologies, some of the references, the acoustics are terrible in this room. When you talk down that way, it's actually, I'm struggling to hear you up at this end of the room.
Apologies, Chair.
And I know the questions will be banging in there, so I suppose Trevor wants to hear them. Look, I've no other indications for anybody to ask a question unless, George, are you looking to ask a question there, or are you okay?
I'm fine.
You're fine. Okay, yeah. No problem. Is there another point you wanted to...
It's just something that I'm reading here, just on the discussion that was important, Mark, thanks, Chair. And it says here quite clearly that widows, widowers and surviving civil partners of all members of the Armed Forces Pension Scheme will now retain their pensions for life. So if they're retaining their pensions for life, they wouldn't be applying for a pension 10 years on, because they've retained it for life.
The difference comes with the widows and spouses and partners, where with war pensions, and we're probably talking about the old war pension scheme mostly for people who would qualify for this. It was only in situations where someone had been at least 80% disabled where the survivor benefits kicked in. So I think there is a difference between the Armed Forces Compensation Scheme, the new scheme, and the former war pension scheme in that regard.
I don't want to take time, but I'm just reading it here. It's all of them. It's the 75 pension scheme. It's the War Widows Pension Scheme. It's the 2015 pension scheme. There's a whole reg of them, but all of them is... On death, their widows, their widowers, their spouses, their partners get the pension for life. So they wouldn't be applying for the 10 years. Anyway.
We're in touch with the Chief Medical Officer in the MOD who's responsible for the War Pension Scheme. So sure. We're having an opportunity to clarify these points. Something else maybe I just should say, it sprung to mind with your point earlier. Yes, of course, there will be... many victims who don't qualify for this scheme. It's designed for a particular set of circumstances, but who would qualify for the other services and support that's available through VSS. And one of the things we want to do is to make sure that anybody who applies is aware that whatever the outcome, that service and support is available to them.
And that's a good point to make, actually. Thank you. Thank you for your indulgence, Chair.
Okay, Mark, thank you very much indeed. I think it's been mentioned by a number of members. There's a lot of movement that has taken place there. Still a fair bit of movement that we'd like to see, but there's a fair bit of movement that's gone on in that scheme, and that's something that we've been asking for. So to see that is actually quite good. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Chair. Thank you.
Be back on the game to talk about money at some point, will it?
Yes. Thank you.
Take just for a moment, just to let the speakers leave. And I know we have, if Shauna's coming in, we'll just need one chair maybe set up for her there. And while that's happening, we should be able just to continue. If we move to item 6, is a research and information briefing paper on the North-South Ministerial Council and the British-Irish Council. It's in page 84 of the meeting pack. We had asked to commission this research and the outcome of meetings as part of the committee's scrutiny for cross-cutting Brexit issues. Our members can attempt to note the research briefing at this stage and include it in next week's paper for information when we will be taking evidence from the Oireachtas Committee. Are members happy enough?
Yeah.
Okay. Item 7 is the Carnegie UK Trust Citizens Engagement with the Programme for Government. It was a written briefing. It's on page 100 of the meeting pack. We I had met with the Carnegie Trust a number of weeks ago, and they had suggested that they may have some information which would be of use to us, so we sought that written briefing from them. That written briefing is contained, and the suggestion is that we would go for an oral briefing when information becomes available on the programme for government. Are members content to note? Mm-hmm. Okay, on item 8 is the Forward Work Programme. It's on page 107 of the meeting pack. Are members content to note what we've got lined up for the next few weeks? Okay. Yep. Item 9 is correspondence. There are 6 items of correspondence on pages 114 to 242 in the meeting pack, and 1 item of correspondence on page 10 in the table pack. Are members content to note, or is there any items that anybody would like to raise from that?
Chair.
Yes, Emma. Yeah, go on ahead.
Yeah, it was just the letter from the women's sector groups around the request for an extension on the consultation that the Bill of Rights Committee is doing. So it was just to note that obviously both myself and Christopher sit on that ad hoc committee. I'm not sure if Christopher has left, but that the committee agreed that extension. So I've already engaged with the women's sector lobbyists, but it was just for a point of information.
But thank you for that, Emma, because actually I noted that the request that they were looking referred to an extension for a meeting that took place last week. So, but that's good to hear that they got that extension that they were looking for. Item 10 is Chairman's Business. Just 2 items. Number 1, last 2 weeks we had met with the councils from the various councils across Northern Ireland, and many of them had indicated that they had issues with the European funding. I had raised with the Finance Minister during the ministerial statement yesterday about the councils and the fact that they had some concerns, and just had asked maybe if he might take an opportunity to meet with them. Now, he did say that he would do that, but I thought maybe if we could just write from this committee, given that we met with the councils over the last 2 weeks, just to formalise that request and just to put a bit of a tracker on it to make sure that it happens. And I think that this is important, because having met the councils and them taking the time and the effort to prepare the briefings and to come and meet us, it might be nice to be able to show them that as a result of that, that there is some tangible outcomes at the other end of it. So, as I said, non-controversial. The Minister said yes, he would be happy to do it, and maybe to do it through the medium of Solus or Nilga. But maybe just if we write the request that so that we've got a track on it, would members be happy enough? Okay. The other item is that I had met last week with the Northern Ireland Youth Forum, and that all parties are attending tomorrow night as political champions. Most parties are attending tomorrow night as political champions for young people. They have conducted a major piece of research of COVID-19 young people's views. There was about 2,500 young people that responded to that, and as the items contained in it, and I got a briefing on it last week, include infrastructure, education, health, right across the whole of the executive. And I know that we did receive today in our email, myself and the clerk have received that report. If members are happy, we'll table that report for next week, and then I think it might be good if we actually got those young people to do a presentation to us, to actually hear their views, hear the issues that young people are saying, and then if we could maybe pass that on to the First and Deputy First Minister and the Executive Office for some follow-up. So would members be happy enough with that?
Yes.
Okay, so we'll get that tabled as a sort of almost written briefing for next week, and then we can make a presentation on the back of that. Is there any other business that members have? Okay, the date, time and place of the meeting is next Wednesday at 2 o'clock here. And members, we are now going to move into closed session for the remainder of the meeting. We've no witnesses by Starleaf, so we don't need to worry about that. So what we will do is we will just, we're going to end the meeting at this stage and thank members for their attendance today.
We're good, and we need comms to put the members in spotlight.
Oh, right, yes. And maybe just to ask communications there, if they're listening, that we have the members all in spotlight, okay, so that they're able to participate. Thank you.
30. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Committee Room 30. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly Committee Room 30. This is the Northern Ireland Assembly, Committee Room 30.